Good morning, everyone, and welcome to St. Aloysius Parish on this 28th Sunday in Ordinary Time. We welcome our celebrant this morning, Father Frankie Airy. Readings this morning will be found on page 509 of your Sunday Missal. I invite everyone to stand for our opening hymn, number 689, The Lord's My Shepherd.
Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of God, you have been away as you May your blessing, Lord, we pray, at all times go before us and follow after, and make us always determined to carry out good works. For our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who is and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of all aged wines. Of rich food filled with marrow, of well aged wines clear, and he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all people, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. For the hand of the Lord will rest on this mountain. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So, as usual, we will sing the antiphon, and I will read the psalm. Follow me all the days of my life, And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
Reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, I know what it is to have little, and I know what it is to have plenty. In any and all circumstances, I have learned the secret of being well fed and of going hungry, of having plenty and of being in need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. In any case, it was kind of you to share my distress. My God will fully satisfy every need of yours according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia.
Alleluia. Alleluia.
May the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ enlighten the eyes of our heart, that we might know the hope to which we are called.
Good morning. Morning, where are you?
I'm Father Jean-Frankie Gary, I'm a Jesuit, and it's a pleasure to be here again to preside to celebrate this sacred Eucharist with you. I was saying today that sometimes, you know, Jesus speaks in parables, and parables are one of the methods Jesus will use to communicate with the people he encountered with his journey. So parables always have an important message to receive, something to embrace or something to avoid. So behind each parable, Jesus really wants to communicate something to his listeners. And sometimes Jesus used parables to some question that some Pharisees ask him to test him and to accuse him. And we know in one of the parables, the Good Samaritan, it was said, well said, they asked him that question to test him. So today, by telling this parable, Jesus wants to teach his audience about the reality of the kingdom of heaven. It is said clearly, he would like to talk about the kingdom of heaven. And the kingdom of heaven is described as a wedding feast. And we see that aspect of peace in the first reading as well in the book of Isaiah and in Matthew's gospel. So Matthew says, once more, Jesus spoke to the chief priests and Pharisees in parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who had given a wedding banquet for his son. So by reading this first sentence from the gospel, brothers and sisters, the first thing I would like to say is that we need to really meditate deeply on our personal response to God's invitation to each one of us to participate in the wedding banquet of his son. What does that mean? It is not enough to receive this invitation, but we need to respond to the call to participate in the dynamic of God's kingdom on earth today, right now, as we live in this world. We must respond with complete faithfulness to this call until we are transformed in accordance with Jesus' teaching and way of proceeding, as St. Ignatius of Loyola was saying. Participating in God's banquet is to know his Son deeply, to love Christ and to imitate him. That's a few words what it means participate, embrace that invitation to be part of this feast, of this great feast. The only thing that matters, as St. Paul says, is Christ. And St. Paul continues saying, my God will fully satisfy every means according to his riches in glory in Christ. So receiving that invitation is receiving Christ, is loving Christ, is knowing Christ. In the first reading, the book of Isaiah, the Lord makes for all peoples a feast of rich food. By doing this, he will also wipe away the tears from all faces and the disgrace of his people. He will take away from all the earth. That's a big promise we receive from God today. We are so lucky to really be part of this continuity, that good promise made with Israel. And we are already today partakers of this as we embrace the Messiah, God's Son. So the banquet described by the prophet Isaiah appears as a celebration. And at the heart of this text is the idea of the banquet, conclude in the ritual sacrifice for Yahweh. Yahweh prepares for his people a joyful participation in the sacrifice of thanksgiving as a style of perfect communion. And we see today the well-known Psalm 22 that was our opening hymn, and we meditated on it at the song for today. This song really expresses our longing as brothers and sisters, as we gather here today, as one church, one body of Christ. The Lord is our shepherd. He prepares a table before us. His goodness and mercy will accompany us all the days of our life. and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord our entire life. That's the meaning of responding to this call, to this invitation today, to be part of this feast, of this great feast. And the Holy Eucharist, brothers and sisters, is this feast. It prepares us to this great moment to be partakers of the Paschal mystery. This is the banquet we're talking about. So we share in the communion of love with the Trinity as we gather here today, and we embrace our nature as men and women, image and likeness of God, to live for God all the days of our life. This is our nature. This is our normal nature. We might decide to live in a different way, but as men and women, as image and likeness of God, our first call, our first vocation is to live for God and is to dwell in His house forever. Because through our baptism, we accept already the invitation to participate in the Lord's banquet and engage in the dynamic of communion that Jesus invites us to. And as the Gospel tells us, no one is forbidden to participate in the wedding banquet. But the most important is the way we respond to the invitation. We can come, we can show up, but the way we respond, for that the last person in the Gospel came, he was ill. We didn't have that wedding want to really be part of this, the way we respond. We can be here, but we are not responding. Matthew tells us today it was the poor who are the better way of receiving the invitation. They receive it with humility and accept the goodness of God's gift with simplicity and humility. In humility of heart, we normally approach the sacrament of reconciliation, the Holy Eucharist, which includes the sharing of the Word of God, as I'm doing right now, and the participation of the Eucharist, the celebration, the Body and Blood of Christ. Thus, we too must first be aware of the invitation to a transformative communion with the Lord, an invitation that is made to us through the Word of God, the preaching of the Gospel, and the participation in God's supper, the Eucharist, receiving the Body and Blood of Christ. My dear brothers and sisters, this parable highlights the great promise of God, which are fulfilled in Christ's incarnation, and which the Church, in her mission of evangelization, proclaims and offers to all people. This is our mission, to really offer this. And the communion of life with God and for our brothers and sisters, which through the work of the Holy Spirit is upgrading the life of all believers at the center of the Eucharist celebration. The liturgy we celebrate today remind us of this every time we prepare to receive the Body and Blood of Christ. And you must know that because we say it every time in Mass. Before communion, the priest says to the faithful, I will say to you today, blessed are those invited to the supper of the Lord. Yes, we are truly blessed because we are being invited to the eternal banquet prepared by God for the whole world. The Eucharist, in fact, brothers and sisters, is a feast of faith. That's how it was called by Alexander. It's a feast of faith because here today we express our faith. We embrace that invitation. It flows the essence of the Christian mystery. In the Eucharist flows the essence of our faith, the mystery of a God who comes closer to us to share a journey with us to the point of giving His Son for us. And this is truly renewed in the Eucharist celebration, which therefore becomes a feast. This feast has its foundation in the mystery of the cross of Christ. Let us, brothers and sisters, ask God with the word of the choir to just begin Mass today, that His grace may continually accompany us on our journey, so that sustained by His grace and by our Mother Mary, we may never cease to respond with humility to the invitation great feast. Amen.
Amen.
My dear brothers and sisters, now let us stand and confess our faith in Christ our Lord as we say together the Apostle Creed. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under the Pontius Pilate, was crucified and died in the dead, he descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Now with humility, with open heart, let us present our prayers to Christ our Lord, and after each intention, we say, Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, hear our prayers.
For the Church, a community committed to faith and justice, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the leaders of nations, called to effective action on behalf of the poor, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For people uprooted by natural disasters, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For innocent people uprooted by war, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For this St. Aloysius community, called as a parish to act justly and lovingly, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those in our parish family, and among our loved ones who are ill, suffering or in convalescence, especially Carole Guillon, Bobby Squires, Clarice Mascarenhas, John Henry, Mathilde Aguilas, Cyril Clément, Maria Maloney, Pierce Corsi, Diane Bannon, Ginny Wayland, Patricia Chancey, and Marilyn Crook. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We also pray in a special way for Marina Chancey and Allan Crook, for whom this Mass is being offered. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our own personal and private intentions, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us ask Mother Mary to join us in our petitions. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women. Blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Lord Heavenly Father, hear the prayer of your people. Fulfill our needs and guide our desires toward the building of your kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. The offertory hymn is number 719. Blessed are the pure.
accept, O Lord, the prayers of your faithful with the sacrificial offerings, that through these acts of devotedness we may pass over to the joy of heaven through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It should be right and just. Our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, for through his pastoral mystery, he accomplished the marvelous deed by which he has freed us from the yoke of sin and death, summoning us to the glory of being now called a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for our own possession, to proclaim everywhere your mighty works. For you have called us out of darkness into your own wonderful light, and so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and all the force and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we are here.
Holy, 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 holy.
Spirit. fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, missionary bishop, all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who are falling asleep in the hope of the resurrection. All who have died in your mercy, welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray. Unto the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the Blessed Joseph, His Father, the Blessed Apostle, and all the saints who are pleased with throughout the ages, you may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life. May praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Thank you.
My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most blessed sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and I unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
As Jacques said, my name is Richard Brisbois. I'm here to speak about the Pillars Trust Fund. If I were to ask you, how many of you are familiar with the Pillars Trust Fund, would you be able to show me your hands? Okay, we have one there, two, three. Okay, so my speech will be a little longer today because obviously you don't know what the Pillars Trust Fund is, so I have to explain it all. I'll be short. The Pillars Trust Fund, first and foremost, is a fundraising organization for the English-speaking Catholic community in Montreal. We've been around for 51 years. Last year we celebrated our 50th year, and you may have had a visit from our director back then, Carol McCormick, who spoke a little bit about all the activities that were planned for the 50th anniversary. You notice there's an old adage that says, if it is to be, it's up to me. Pillars of Supplies has been around for 51 years and is there because of people like you and me, people who have dug into our pockets and provided the kind of income that Pillars needed to support the Church of Montreal. I'm just going to reach into my pocket here. I wrote 5 pages of text to speak. Just one. Just want to stress the importance of the Pillars Trust Fund within the community of Montreal. First and foremost, in the past 10 years, we have not been a patron saint for the Pillars Trust Fund. That's Saint Jean Vianney, and he is the patron saint of parish priests, because we deal a lot with the parish priests in the Diocese of Montreal in getting from them ideas of how we can help the community, especially in the areas of faith and faith studies. And one of the, or three of the main pillars of the Pillars Trust Fund, one is the Diocesan Priesthood Guild. And there we provide money for any seminarian who goes into the seminary to study to become a priest. He doesn't have to worry about his lodging or his food or even the cost of his education for the priesthood. All of that is paid through the Pillars Trust Fund, through you and through me. We also look after the Newman Center in Montreal, which is a center that welcomes international students into the province of Quebec. And the Newman Center there are many of them through many universities around the world. And it's a place where they can feel at home and be at home in their faith as well. And also, we are responsible for looking educational needs of English Catholics in Montreal. If any of you have ever participated in any actions here that improve the state of your faith in Montreal, that's through the Pillars Trust Fund and because of your donations through yourselves. So the Diocesan Priesthood Guild is one of our major funders. Also, you may have heard of Nazareth House in Montreal that looks after the poor and the needy by providing housing for them and lodging. The English-speaking Catholic Council of Montreal is another one of our beneficiaries. Momentum, which we just started funding about 3 years ago, is a program for single mothers, single Catholic mothers in Montreal. The Ignatian Spirituality Center in Montreal, which you may be a part of, is a place where people are educated in the faith of the spiritual exercise, the same nation of Loyola. Also, Montreal directed retreats. If you've ever participated in a retreat in Montreal and haven't had the funds to support your weekend away, spirituality, Pillars Trust Fund is there to help. Catholic Action in Montreal, which I'm sure you've heard about. The Newman Center, which I mentioned, and also Camp Caritas. But I think one of the most important things that we've had in the last little while, especially during the pandemic and coming out of the pandemic, is that Pillars Trust Fund has been responsible for helping a lot of parishes maintain their connectivity between the parish and the people, especially people who couldn't go to church during that particular time. Pillars helped many parishes get the kind of audiovisual equipment that helped them have a Mass each and every Sunday and broadcast that Mass to their community. And I think that is one of the important things that's very, very special about the Pillars Trust Fund. So for us to be around, and I say us because I worked for Pillars Trust Fund for 30 years, and then I retired in 2020, and I'm back with Pillars now as helping out in the office and doing some work for them. So Pillars has meant a lot to me and my family. It's very important that those of you who have been involved with the Pillars Trust Fund, and the fact that we are who we are because of people like you and me, I think is very, very important. So I encourage your support of the Pillars Trust Fund. It's there for you, for us as English Catholics in the Diocese of Montreal. And its founder, Bishop Leonard Crowley, who many years ago was very grateful. He's the one that said many years ago when it started in 1972, he says, if we're to have the kind of services and activities spiritually for the Catholic community in Montreal, it is up to us. So we often used to say that the faithful people still fill our churches, and that is a very good sign. It's a sign that we're always willing to serve others. So help us at the Pillars Trust Fund continue our mission to serve others in the Diocese of Montreal. Thank you very much for your time.
Could you possibly have taken a sheet of paper that wasn't yours?
Yeah, I might do that.
That would help. Wait. Thank you.
Thank you. Just wanted some information about the parish.
May I just point out that Monsieur Brisbois is a permanent deacon. So that's something important too. Thank you for having chosen that path. And thank you very much, Father Frankie, for being a priest for us. We need more priests. We need to pray for them, and we need to help financially. It's that simple. Now, there's tons of announcements that one could do, but they're all in a parish bulletin. So I think that we better leave them aside just for the time being. But thank you for coming and praying with us. The more we pray together, the more our prayers will be answered. And God, do we need to pray? You look at the world of today. I just shudder to think about it. Now, so please look at the bulletin for the various things that Hope is doing, like looking for clothes for the people of Library House, the Adopt a Child campaign and the Christmas gift. All these things are asked of us by God to do in the measure that we can do it. We are supposed to be like Jesus and so do things like he would do. But now there's also two kittens who need help if you can. But I will now go to the birthdays and anniversaries. On the 17th, there's somebody who's not coming here, but she's online. Rosemary Callagher, who will be celebrating her birthday. On the 18th, there will be Melissa Robertson. On the 21st, Emmanuel Campion. And there's an anniversary for Rowan Mascarenas and Kathleen Leck. So,
who is it? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Church's One Foundation, number 604.